Well, hello everybody. I'm glad that we have a packed house today. Try not to bump into your neighbor, like Michelle said, and so graciously introduced me as a alumni of the Academy. So I'm going to begin by directing some of these words to the students. When I was here, I got a degree in graphic design, and I also took drawing and painting classes, which ultimately led to a degree in fine art painting. So I'm an artist who likes to incorporate both of those styles in everything I do, which leads me to the presentation. So I was invited to speak because I just recently released a self-published children's book that I worked on with a friend of mine from college. And it's called The World Is Yours. So this is one of the drawings. And I brought several of the beginning drawings that you guys could pass around. And I didn't take watercolor classes when I was here, but this is a watercolor media that I used in addition to markers and the pencil drawing for the underlayer. And this is kind of what began the project for Ben and I. So I'll start by saying a little bit about Ben. Ben and I used to DJ parties together, so our introduction as friends was in music. And I really didn't have a focus on visual arts when he and I used to hang out as kids until I took my first art class at Howard University, and I kind of felt that that was the place I should be. So I left Howard University. Ben and I were no longer friends because he moved to Brooklyn. I moved back to Chicago to attend the Academy. One day through the magic of Facebook, we reconnected, and he was sharing some of his poetry, and I suggested that he turn the poem into a children's book. And he thought it was an excellent idea, so we began working together on what would become The World Is Yours. So the first drawing symbolizes, I guess, the magic of an inventive mind. And I like to use the word magic because it's something that I believe in. It doesn't have to be this intangible thing, you know, because our ideas, although they're intangible, ultimately become tangible things. So I like to think of it as a form of magic. And if you look at the etymology of the word magic, which is basically the study of the origin of words and their breakdown, the etymology is magi, which means wise one, and magic is ultimately the arts of the wise. So I like to emphasize that the creation process is ultimately magic because we bring our ideas as artists to life. We create what doesn't exist. We make the world a better place. Even the chairs that you're sitting in ultimately had a designer. So you look around and everything that was created had a creator, the same as with us. So this book is basically a paying homage to the creator. So if you look at this picture, for example, the main character is this young boy. He's African American because I wanted him to reflect my friend who's the author of the book. He's, you know, a black guy, so he was writing the book, he was writing the poem to his children. So basically embracing the children of the world, but also if it was directed to his child in general. So we wanted the book to have a universal appeal, you know, and I believe that the universe has a way of connecting us with nature. Although we're supposedly these divine, intelligent beings, I think we still have connections with animals and, you know, the plants and just the earth in general, you know, I believe has a connection with how we operate. So for this picture, a woman asked me, well, why can you see the planets and the stars and it's daytime? And I said, well, that's part of the magic of being an artist. You can create whatever you want, basically. Like, it doesn't have to be limited to what exists. You know, you basically create what you want to create. And I think from a child's perspective, they could probably relate to that a little more than adults, since we're kind of confined to the realities of our everyday lives, whereas a child is still in these innocent, imaginative stages where they can grasp the concept that you can have planets and stars in the daytime. So, as I mentioned, I have a graphic design degree. I wanted to kind of utilize all of my skill set. So after I did the drawings, I began generating the layout. And since I'm most proficient, not excellent, but I can use Photoshop, it's limited capabilities. So I dumped everything into Photoshop, I scanned all my images, and began putting a layout together for several of the images, which eventually led to me adding text in the areas that I thought they would fit. So, you know, these are things that I learned in class doing different projects where we're assigned to create, like, for example, a mock-up magazine or something like that. You know, you want to make sure the text is bold enough where it's emphasized. You want to make sure the images are balanced and everything in relation on the page has symmetry and vividness and everything like that. So, you know, I wanted to utilize a lot of the skills I was taught in school in a professional way, because ultimately that's what coming to school is for. Especially here at the Academy, you know, they emphasize making art a career. So in order to be professional, I had to take everything I learned and meld it all together and try to put together the best product that I could. In some instances, some of the images I came up with didn't work. They didn't really reflect the vision that the poem was supposed to convey. So I went back and reworked a lot of images, and it was gut-wrenching, tedious, meticulous work, and, you know, Ben and I were at odds a lot of the time. And there was one thing that I learned from that, is that my opinions don't always matter. As an artist, we always think what we're doing is best. We're also the most critical of our own work as artists. So sometimes we can either propel things that we believe in too much that aren't necessarily great, or we could also stifle or impede our own progress by not being as confident in one particular thing because we're uncertain. And I think Aaron and I talked about this earlier, is, you know, sometimes those are the projects where other people on the outside looking in are like, wow, those are some of the best concepts you've created. So we kind of have to allow ourselves to become vulnerable in most cases and give other people the benefit of the doubt, add their input, and change accordingly. And that doesn't mean sacrificing who you are and basing your entire existence on the opinion of others. It just means be considerate. You know, I think that's what being in tune with nature and being in tune with the universe also teaches us, is that, you know, the flowers, the plants, the fish, the sun, the planets, the stars, everything exists because it's considerate of one another and there's this balance. So, another part of the book was, like I said, trying to make it the best product possible. So one of the things Ben and I bumped heads on was the font. So the font is basically just like regular Comic Sans, you know, you just find it in Microsoft Word or, you know, any basic program. And he's like, man, it's just so simple and plain and disgusting. And I'm like, no, it's great. You know, kids don't care what it looks like. And you know, that was me trying to push something forward that I believed in and him adding some input. So it's nice to have, you know, somebody to kind of bounce ideas off of. And in school, I think I had one or two friends that I was able to bounce ideas off of, and I learned quickly that networking is very important, and finding people who can not just be friends with you, but compete with you as well, you know, because we need competition in order to grow and to become successful. And it's not always like unhealthy competition where it's like, you know, it's a rivalry going on, but, you know, it's like being honest with each other, saying, you know, that idea doesn't really work well, why don't you try this? And it could be something I never even considered, like, oh yeah, I'll try it. So, you know, ultimately I was like, I like it the way it is. So I printed a copy of the book with my own money, with the simple, ugly font, and I used my kids as guinea pigs, and, you know, started marketing the book. And I think initially we wanted to try to find like some large publishing company to pick us up and give me $1 million, and, you know, we'd be famous the next day and our books would be national bestsellers. And that was the idea I had in my mind. It didn't go that way. So, you know, regardless of how cute my kids are, they didn't have the impact that I wanted to generate. So, you know, I kind of looked at the book and I said, oh yeah, I think Ben was right, it's kind of ugly. So I went back and I reworked it, and I did a little, you know, because I did a little graffiti before going to art school, so I tried to incorporate that and change up the font a little bit. So, you know, I started going through different versions of the cover that I thought would maybe make it pop a little bit more, so that, you know, as I learned in school, if you see something on a shelf and you don't notice it, you're not going to buy it. You know, it has to pop out to you. It has to speak to you. So I settled on one design and decided, instead of paying for somebody else to do a mock-up, I would just make a little mock-up myself. So this one's kind of like 3 by 4 inches or something like that. So, you know, it was something my children could hold. It's like, oh yeah, it's nice, it's cute, it's, you know. And then it just still wasn't right, but we decided, okay, we don't have money to print the book. Nobody wants to give us any money to print the book. So what's the next best thing? We decided to do a fundraiser on Kickstarter. So we put together this huge campaign. This is one of the flyers that I used to pass around. And, you know, it's basically like a job, you know what I mean? It's like when you get an internship at some art agency or something and you're just running around doing all this work. Basically, the work you put in for somebody else, if you expect to be successful, you have to put in the work for yourself. So we put in a lot of work, a lot of hours on Photoshop, putting things together. You know, like I said, just putting together flyers, putting together posters, just anything that could help spread the word. And in this age of social media, we took advantage of that. On Instagram, he has a podcast called fanbros.com where they, you know, highlight like comic book culture. And we took to Twitter, Facebook, you know, anything, everything, Tumblr, anything you could reach a larger audience with. And we just began spreading the word. So I started typing out like paragraphs full of why you should buy this book and why it's so great. And nobody was reading it. So he's like, yeah, just put like one line. So a book is a dream you hold in your hand. You know, it's like, oh yeah, it's a dream. So, you know, we started learning that if we tell more about ourselves as opposed to really pushing the product, then people kind of gravitate towards your story more than they will what you're selling. So it's like you tend to look at a lot of successful businesses, and for the most part, it's their backstory that's their selling point. You know, how they began, where the product originated, you know. So Ben started talking about his experience that made him write the poem. So he's not here to tell it, so I'm probably gonna tell it wrong, but he was on his way to DJ a party in Ethiopia, and he said, oh, I'm gonna stop in Dubai and, you know, just have some fun. You know, he's a world traveler, not like me. I'm kind of confined to the house with my children, washing dishes and cooking dinner. And so, yeah, they stopped him at the airport because he's, you know, tall black guy, dreadlocks, and, you know, they have this zero tolerance policy for anything other than Arabs. So they stop him, and, you know, apparently he had the smell of marijuana on him or something. So he ended up going to prison for a year. Zero tolerance policy. So he's in prison, he's wondering why. And he begins to think of his family, of course. He's in a totally different country, overseas. You know, nobody can visit him, nobody can contact him. So he starts writing poetry to his nieces and nephews, who the book is ultimately dedicated to. And, you know, he begins the story, you know, to the children of the world, to all the parents, you know, everybody trying to do their job to make this world a better place, you know, let's kind of come together and get it done. So, you know, like I said, when I saw the poem, it resonated with me, and I thought it would be a great way to connect with children by adding a visual effect to it. So, this one says, make it a rule never to give a child a book you wouldn't read yourself. So I like to emphasize the book as something that children of all ages can enjoy, you know, because it's in a poetry format. It's poetic enough that adults can understand it and learn from it, but it's simple enough that a child can read it and learn from it and kind of advance through their reading curriculum with, you know, as they encounter different ways of expressing themselves poetically. So I don't really put a limit on the age group who the book is confined to. You know, I kind of tell people to use their own discretion because, to tell the truth, I think half the people that bought the book are adults anyway. So this is the cover we ultimately ended up with, and it's a lot cleaner. You know, I went in Photoshop and I had a lot of paint splatters, you know, and I just didn't feel like it was the book I wanted to put out and promote me as an artist. So this is the clean version, the end result of the cover. And, you know, again, I went into Photoshop and Illustrator, you know, because Illustrator, I guess, makes the text a little more crisp. So I went into Photoshop, and this is pretty much how you have to submit a book to the printer when you want it printed. You have to make it 300 DPI. You know, the images have to be large enough so that if you print them large, they still come out sharp. And if you print them small, they, you know, still retain their sharpness and the emphasis. So I made sure to scan all my images at 600 DPI so that when I put them at 300 DPI, they were still very sharp. So the inner pages of the book, you know, obviously they're only one page, so you submit them like that. But this PDF, I had to consider the book as it is when it's opened, because that's the entire printable area. So you have to measure the spine, you gotta measure the pages, you have to consider that the book is gonna bleed, so it kind of wraps around. And I had several mock-up books made before we actually put it to the mass production print. So there's a lot of different stages you have to go through when you make the book. And I think that fortunately our Kickstarter campaign was a success, otherwise I wouldn't be here today presenting this to you. So I think our goal was to just raise enough money just to print 500 copies of the book, and ultimately those 500 copies would go to the people who donated to the Kickstarter fund. And in order to, I guess, attract more attention, we decided, you know, we would have different incentives for different donation levels. So for example, $20, you get a book. $25, you get a book and a signature. Since Ben is a DJ, he said, oh yeah, I can make a personalized mix for people so that they can get, like, you know, the music they enjoy, and I'll mix it for them. So that was another level. Then we decided to give away posters. So if you buy a book, you get an autographed poster. So this was one of the posters we put together from the pages of the book. And, you know, that was one of the tiers of the rewards you got. And then I think one of the final tiers was the original artwork. You would donate a certain amount and you get to get an original piece of artwork from the creation of the book. So, you know, of course, I'm not gonna give away all the artwork, so it was limited to five. You know, you kinda have to think ahead in those instances and say, well, you know, one day the book may actually be successful, so maybe I should hold on to some of the artwork, which I did. So nobody tried to steal any artwork. I'm just joking. But yeah, so after badgering me forever, I decided to change the font. I found a font that I thought would fit. I played around with the color of the font and, you know, just made it fit the images a little better. So in addition to playing with the font, you know, I played around with a lot more of the graphic elements and just made the book a little more cohesive, a little more dynamic, so that when you look at it, it has more vivid color, it's a little more lively, and from a child's perspective, you know, it would keep their attention. So fortunately, we've had some people buy some of the original artwork, so I would give them a certificate of authenticity. You know, if you're selling paintings in a gallery, which I do often, it's nice to give people a little extra provenance and things to go along with it to just make it official. You know, collectors like to feel like they're getting something special, and in most cases they like collecting original things. So I include certificates of authenticity with a lot of my pieces. This is the poster design. So it has like all of our social media information on there, our logos, and, you know, things that if you want to find us anywhere, you can. Alleyne Art on Instagram if you need to find me. So in addition to getting the book, you know, I wanted to make sure that we added a special touch for everybody that donated. Put the little postcard in there, you know, and since it took us so long to get the book completed and printed, we just decided we'll both sign it, and, you know, everybody got a signature in the book. So, you know, it's just little special touches that make people realize that, you know, art can be very impersonal and informal in this day of social media, where you can reach a large audience, but it's not as intimate as perhaps it once was, when you could talk directly to people, collectors could come to your show and meet the artist. Now it's kind of like online galleries take the place of that, and gallery exhibitions have kind of turned into just social gatherings where people aren't really interested in looking at the artwork. So, after our book was printed, we did our first book signing. I was fortunate enough to have built up kind of a network of artists and professionals over my years as a professional artist myself after graduating from the academy. I think when I first graduated in 98, I had a degree in graphic design. And a friend of mine introduced me to a girl who gave me the business card of one of her friends who happened to be in New York. And she said, if you're ever in New York, look him up. I'm like, I live in Chicago, I'm never gonna be in New York. And like I said, art is this magical thing where things just beyond your imagination kind of begin happening if you believe in yourself and you believe in the magical aspect of creation. So a friend of mine's like, hey, I'm moving to New York, you wanna move in with me? I'm like, oh, yeah, that sounds interesting. You know, at the time I didn't have any children, no responsibilities or obligations, and you know, it was real easy for me to pack up and move. So I decided to call this guy whose business card I got from this random person that I met through a friend. And he said, you know, no, we're not really looking for anybody right now. He was working for a record label that at the time was putting out a lot of rap music. And a lot of the popular rappers, I think, were like Exhibit. You may know him from like Pimp My Ride. He was just coming out as a rapper. There were a few artists from the Wu-Tang Clan and, you know, what's the group Mobb Deep and you know, several other artists, R&B artists as well. So, you know, I really wanted to work with them. And I said, you know, I really can't take no for an answer. So, you know, let me know when you have a position available for me and I'll make myself available. You know, I felt like I moved all the way to New York for something. It had to be this. So the following week, I called him on a Monday. I said, hey, you got anything available for me? He said, no, it's only been a week. No, I don't have anything for you. So I called him the next week, the following Monday. And he said, no, I don't have anything for you. I called him the next week. He said, okay, come in. I may have an internship for you. It's not paying anything. I said, fine. So that was my first lesson, that persistence pays off. You know, it's really easy as an artist. You put your heart and soul into something you create, and you know, when you encounter failure, it's like a direct reflection of rejection of you in your entirety. It's like, man, they rejected my soul. They rejected my entire existence because I put everything that I am into the creation process of my art. So, you know, I learned that I'm not taking no for an answer. Failure is just an illusion. And in fact, it's just an obstacle. You know, if failure is here, then you may bump into it, but you can go around it, you can jump over it, you know, just like in track and field. They put obstacles in your way to help you become a more superior athlete. So there are obstacles put in our paths to help us excel and become better individuals in whatever path in life we choose to pursue. So, persistence paid off. I got in, you know, I was working as an assistant art director in New York. I'm happy. I'm like, wow, I did it. And then I'm working behind a computer, you know, doing logo designs and working on album covers. And I said, man, I really hate this. And I worked so hard to get here. What do I do? And at that point, you know, I said again, I don't have any real obligations. They're not paying me. I don't know anybody here in New York that really cares if I leave or not. So ultimately, I left New York and I decided to come back to the academy and pursue painting, because while I was in New York, the majority of my time was spent painting. And I realized I love painting more than anything else in the world. And I think that that's an important process as an artist, is finding what you love doing. Because collectors will also see that, and it'll come through in your work that, wow, this person really loves what they're doing. And if I don't get a piece of their work, then I'm not gonna show them that I love, that they love themselves. You know, because collectors collect what they love, for one, But they, like I said, they also enjoy learning about the artists they collect. So, make a long story short, my artwork came to be because of the network of friends that I have in the art world over a 20 year or so span. And a friend of mine said, you know, I have a connection at the DuSable Museum. So our first book signing ended up being in a museum in their bookstore. So not only did we have a successful book signing, we also have our books sold in the museum. So after that, you know, we figured we're doing pretty well. You know, we raised some money to get the book printed. We actually exceeded our goal quite substantially. I think we set a goal, like I said, for 500 books to be printed, and we ended up making almost $10,000. So, you know, that gave us a little bit of money to market, you know, do a campaign to advertise and actually print extra books. So now we have people endorsing our books. This is my dentist. he's special to me because before this book was even created, he's one of those people who really encourage reading. So I encourage reading, you know, and he emphasizes that reading kind of unlocks different things, different imaginative aspects of us. And, you know, you add that with visual art, then you kind of get the history of the world in a nutshell. You know, ever since the dawning of man, they've been creating art and they've been creating language. So you put those two together and you have history. So what we're doing here is making history as artists. So you have to learn how to live your life in such a way that it becomes an art form. This is an art collector. You know, like I said, it's amazing that he would buy a book, because he normally just buys like original artwork and things like that. But, you know, it's really nice to see the fruit come from the tilling and the harvesting and all the effort that you put into producing the fruit. So basically, these are people endorsing the book. Then we have children reading the book to younger children. And I think when I was a child, my biggest inspiration was my older brother, not necessarily my parents, you know, because we tend to gravitate to our peers for guidance, our siblings. You know, they're, in addition to our parents, kind of our first teachers, our friends at school. You know, like I said, we counter each other, we compete with each other, and we sharpen each other's skills. You know, I think that's the important thing of having a classroom environment, is that you get to see each different person. Like for instance, in a figure studies class, you have the same exact model, but you go around the room, each person has their own interpretation of the model. And, you know, we learn by examining each other's styles, how to incorporate, how to add or subtract to make what we are creating better. And I guess, you know, the reason I'm standing here in front of you is only because of one thing. You know, I put together the pieces of the invisible magical puzzle. So you're wondering what that means. So, you know, there's a puzzle that, you know, we have, and if you look in the mirror, you'll see the box. You know, there's an image. And you look in the mirror, it's you. You know, people's perception of you, it's their ideas of you, but it's also your idea of yourself. And the puzzle pieces are your ideas. So your ideas are the invisible, magical pieces that, you know, throughout your career as an artist, you gather and you put together, and, you know, similar to a puzzle, you begin with the outside. You know, so you're gathering all these things in art school, you know, other people are giving you instruction, and those are kind of like the boundaries, you know, those are the straight edges, you know, the pieces that are easy to put together, because you know the straight edges go on the outside. So as you begin to connect and frame the image, you have to start working on the inner piece of the puzzle. So you can kind of encounter pieces that don't necessarily fit the way you want them to, and it could be one of two things. It could be one, the piece just doesn't fit, it looks like it fits, but it doesn't. Or it can be that you have to rotate the piece. So life is about perspective. You know, you see things from one way for so long because it's ingrained in you that this is the way life is, this is the way it should be. We've developed our prejudices about the world and how it should act in accordance with you. But, you know, sometimes you have to flip the puzzle piece and see it from someone else's perspective, and that's the whole compromise of that universal balance. So eventually you flip the piece and it fits into place. And the more you begin to get a clear picture of that image of you and your invisible magical puzzle, you begin to understand that the most important elements of the puzzle are what's on the inside, and what's on the inside is what comes from your heart and what make up you as an artist, you know, because that's the only thing that's going to differentiate you from everyone else. So of course, the older you get, you find that putting together this puzzle is very complicated. So that comes with having more pieces to put together. You know, because when you're young, there's less pieces, you know, there's less clutter, there's less distractions, there's less responsibility. And you look at a child's puzzle, what is it? Maybe six pieces. You know, you're thinking about food, you're thinking about sleep, you're thinking about coloring, you know, whatever those six things are, they're just the basic essentials of what life is comprised of. So it's easy to put those things together. So I guess I'll try to conclude by saying that once you get your puzzle piece magically fit together, you get all your ideas together, and you think about what it is that you want to represent you as an artist, you can do one of two things. You can glue the puzzle together and set it for life. You can frame it, put it behind glass, put it, you know, behind your desk when you become successful and say, this is what got me here. Or you could take the puzzle pieces apart and start a new puzzle. And I think that's what I've done over my course of an artist, is say to myself, you know, I'm gonna be an artist for the rest of my life. And once we find ourselves in a position that we're no longer learning, we're no longer growing, we're finished with this image, then it's time to start something new. So even though this is the book that I'm presenting to you today, this is my completed project, I feel like there's several different aspects that make me an artist. Like I said, I have a love for painting, but that doesn't stop me from exploring doing linoleum tile cuts. You know, that doesn't stop me from doing sculpture. That doesn't stop me from still exploring what I learned at the academy by hiring models and doing figure studies. Actually, I asked a group of artists to come together at the community art center. I'll hire a model and get together a bunch of professional artists, and we'll all work from the model, you know, just to kind of sharpen our skills, to keep me in a place where I feel like I didn't waste money on coming to school and learning how to draw from models, and then I no longer utilize it. So, you know, I just do a lot of different things that are challenging to me in addition to the things that I enjoy doing, because, you know, life is about confronting our challenges and confronting our obstacles, and eventually that's what helps us overcome those obstacles, because there's no way to completely get rid of any challenges. Even when you're in class, you know, you're given assignments because it's something you're not familiar with. It's something you have to push yourself to complete. And, you know, when you get out of school, it's going to be the same challenges that you're presented with. And I think it's important for people like me to come back and say there's no magic formula. It's just following the steps that you learn in school and implementing that into the real world. You know, it's sad to say, but like sometimes I feel like the world is a big college. You know, there's gossip and there's, you know, the social aspects and there's cliques. And when you get caught up in all of that, you get caught up in other people's success. You get caught up in people telling you what to do. Even some of the teachers may feel like, you know, I'm the teacher and what I'm telling you is the law. And if you don't follow what I give you, you know, to the extreme measure, then you're gonna fail the class. You know, that's life. And you have to learn at some point, you have to step out on your own and realize the potential of yourself and realize that each of us individually have a place in the world. So that's why the world is yours. So at this point, I'll take any questions, because I feel like I've been talking your ear off and I don't want to bore you any further.
Question, David?
I've got a quick question, yeah. Fascinating journey, by the way, and it sounds like you've, you know, this persistence, this determination, you've learned a tremendous lot just in this project alone. Mm-hmm. And I know this is the tip of the iceberg, because I've seen your work online, and you mentioned liner cuts, mm-hmm. and massive paintings as well that you do. So having learned so much from this particular project, do you have any plans to illustrate any more? And does Ben have any plans to write any poems, especially perhaps about how he was released eventually from prison? Because I mean, that's another question entirely, I know, but do you have any plans, and can you tell us a little bit about when he was released? Because after a year, you said he was there. It must have been quite an experience.
Yeah, I mean, I would probably be very vague in trying to explain his experience, but I know that he has several projects now. For example, he was working on a podcast for the last few years, and it's called Fan Bros. It's, you know, you can find it at fanbros.com. Like I said, they kind of highlight and emphasize, much in the same manner they do here at the Academy, like the Marvel comics, and, you know, he's a comic book collector, so he's always been interested in the artists, the companies that produce the art, independent comic books, you know, so he's involved in an online project where they kind of highlight those different aspects of a more of an underground art culture. And I think this year they're putting together a pilot to have it actually filmed and perhaps turn it into a visual series, maybe television, you know, it could be streamed live, or, you know, I think we also have ideas about an animated series. We're working on an audiobook. So I think as far as the illustrative aspect, this is kind of my first project, so I want to see where this goes before going out on another endeavor. And, you know, I've been approached by people who ask me to illustrate their projects that they've written, but I don't really feel as confident in my approach as an illustrator as I do as a painter, you know, because I feel like the painting aspect, although it's personal to me, I feel a lot more comfortable exposing my vulnerability in that particular genre of art, as opposed to something that's mass produced and, you know, has the potential to kind of reach a larger audience. You know, I don't want to just pick projects just because they're coming at me. You know, I'd rather take the time and choose things that are relevant, personal to me, and carry the same type of weight and emphasis as this project did. You know, with us being friends for over 20 years, you know, we kind of have some of the same worldviews. You know, so it has to be somebody I'm comfortable with working with, because, like I said, it was several points along the way where I was willing to give up and give him all the rights to the book, and, you know, it's very frustrating working with other people when I'm used to working by myself. But as far as, you know, him being released from prison, I think that, you know, there's a certain thing about sacrifices that we go through in life that at the time it seems like the worst thing possible that could be happening to us. And, you know, when we finally overcome that situation and begin to see aspects of different opportunities happening because of those experiences, you know, I don't think that he would be as strong, he or I, you know, because I've had instances where I've been challenged and gone through several obstacles myself. You know, I wasn't in prison for a year, but, you know, it was certainly things that I felt mentally and physically were straining on me, that without them, I wouldn't have developed the resilience, I wouldn't have developed the idea to stay as determined and dedicated as I am to continuing a project and seeing it through to its completion. But as far as, like, the future for me, you know, I just enjoy conceptualizing. I don't always create to put together a series of work. Sometimes I make one painting and it may sit for several years before I get back to it and create something similar to it. Like I said, I have several different styles of work that I do. I have a series of cityscape collages that are made entirely of silk and gold leaf. And, you know, if I put three of my different series of work in the gallery here, you would think that it was three completely different artists. So, you know, I don't really like saying what I'm gonna do next, because, you know, that's kind of the magic that I've experienced along the way, is embracing the unknown. Like, some of the things that I create, I wouldn't say they happen out of nowhere, but when the occasion arises, you kind of have to be ready to take on the responsibility, so to speak. I don't know if that makes sense, but, you know, people say there's no such thing as luck, there's no such thing as coincidence. You know, it's basically just being prepared for when an opportunity presents itself to you. So I guess, you know, all I continue to do is learn different things about what will make me more professional, learn things that will help me master my craft, and when the next project presents itself, you know, I'll be ready to take on the challenges, and hopefully that work will be superior to my last work.
Will you ever use Comic Sans again? I suppose I should ask that.
Probably.
Okay.
Yeah. It just as the. Yeah. No, I'll never use Comic Sans. No, he hated it, and now I hate it. Yeah. Any other questions?
Yes. Excellent presentation. Fascinating Kickstarter project. Can you talk a little bit more about how you determine the prices, maybe that, getting to the nuts and bolts of that stuff more? You know, I imagine figuring shipping costs and all that stuff. And
the prices of the tiers and Kickstarter.
The tiers and stuff like that.
You know, honestly, we didn't even consider shipping. You know, it was kind of an afterthought, like, oh, we have to actually ship things to people. You know, so if we had just met our mark, we probably wouldn't have had any money after we printed the book to ship them to people. So that was the fortunate thing about exceeding the goal.
Okay.
How did we select the different tiers? You know, honestly, as an artist, I think most of the time, you know, when I'm selling paintings, I tend to undervalue my work because I have this idea that you don't necessarily have to be money motivated. You just want people to own the work. You know, so I try to value things that are fair so that if you're a collector, you're an established collector, I mean, of course, you can afford it because you kind of have the finances put aside where you know you're going to continue collecting art. But at the same time, people come in and they're like, oh, I have to save for a couple of years to put together some money to buy some of your work. And I'm kind of like, no, you really don't. You know, you can start with a down payment. You can start with a payment plan. You can start by, you know, buying something that's not as valuable and then begin adding to your collection. So when I was thinking about the book, I wanted to kind of utilize that same format. So, you know, like I said, when you start adding on the incentives, you know, you say, well, you get an assigned poster. So that's, you know, something that as an artist, you get the signature, it's worth a little bit more. You know, so you have original artwork. You say, well, you know, I can determine that the price of the original artwork would be X amount. So if they pay that amount, they'll get the artwork and the book, you know, in addition to the signature. So, you know, it wasn't like rocket science trying to put together the different scales, but, you know, it was something that we wanted to feel like we would benefit from, but at the same time, we wouldn't miss out on people who wanted to donate but couldn't.
Did you have an idea of how much it would cost to print and stuff? Did you have this?
No, not at all. You know, we experimented with several different printers. In the beginning, we kind of just looked online and researched different printing companies. I think there was a site called printninja.com we ultimately ended up wanting to go with initially. So I spent maybe 3 years, you know, reworking the book and also getting like proof copies, mock-up copies made, and I think they were charging maybe $4 a book for a hardcover, you know, full color with the full bleed front and back, and you know, I think that quote that we received from them determined the quote of what our end goal was for the Kickstarter campaign. And I think it wasn't until after we started the campaign that I just started, you know, doing a little more research. So I talked to a friend of mine who owns a bookstore in my neighborhood in Hyde Park. And, you know, I had been buying books from the store, I mean, many, many years, you know, probably when the bookstore opened, you know, I was buying books from them. And they had a children's book section. And I asked him, you know, oh, you know, who do you get your books printed by? You know, I'm interested in finding out some more information. And I think I got the books from him for maybe half the cost because they had their books printed in China. So I guess all the cheap labor is in China for some reason. You know, it's sad because it was probably like some 10-year-old kid working the printer. No, I'm just, I hope I'm just joking, but it's an ongoing process until you actually finish the book. Like you never really finish until it's finished. It's like a championship game almost. You know, you think you won, and then they come back and then they hit another point and then they're ahead of you again. It's like that was pretty much my experience making this book. It's like I thought we were at the end, and then another obstacle came, and it was like, wow, this the color is not turning out the way I wanted, the book's not printed the way I wanted. You know, it was a point where I had to add pages to it because their printer was printing the pages on the wrong side of the book. So I had to make the book more balanced so that they could comprehend the vision that I was trying to get across. Like, this page coincides with this page, and they flow into each other. So they have to face each other, you know, and they, no, but this is page one, you know, because on the PDF I sent them, if it's page one, it starts on this side. You know, so it's like learning the printer's format, and then if you get something printed by a professional printer, you know, it has to be CYMK and or is it RGB? You know, it's one of them that their professional printers will only read. I think it's RGB, and I submitted it in CYMK, and they were like, oh, it's all wrong. And I had to go back and do all the Photoshop files all over again. It was just a headache. And you know, like I said, I learned how to do Photoshop in 1998. So I was using Photoshop 1, and it wasn't compatible with any of their systems. And, you know, it was just like they were messing up stuff, and I couldn't continue just paying for proof copies. So at one point, I'm fortunate enough to work for an art gallery. I manage the framing department, so one of my coworkers runs our printing department. So she went and converted everything to PDF, converted everything to their RGB format for me. And, you know, like I said, it's important to have a network of people. You know, I think the common phrase goes around teamwork makes the dream work. So I definitely employ that concept in all of my projects.
Okay, thanks, Marcus.
Yes.
Your work is very spiritual, not religious, but very spiritual. Have you ever considered, instead of doing illustrations, someone else's writings, to put one together yourself?
Actually, I've done several projects like that.
Oh, okay.
And nobody cares about them. So that's the benefit of collaborating with somebody.
Yeah.
Is they may have a target audience that is more interested in one aspect of of what you do, and it's nice to have several different people involved in a project because that opens you up to a broader audience.
Yeah, but you know, you might be able to go back to those later, put another twist on it or update it.
Well, I thought about it.
Yeah,
I thought about it, and you know, the books are still available in like ebook format.
Oh.
So. You know, they're still, and like I think when I initially put out the book, it was on Smashwords. You know, it's like this website where you can create your own site where you sell your ebooks, and it was available for like 99 cents. And I think I made $1 off of it from what they take in commission for selling. You know, so I maybe sold 2 copies. So that was
these
fun.
These books for sale that you have here?
Yeah, actually I have some books for sale, and if you want a signature as well, I'd be happy to sign it. And they're also available on theworldisyoursbook.com. That was another thing we put together after the Kickstarter campaign. We wanted the book to be available to the public. You know, obviously it was a long process getting the books shipped to everyone in the Kickstarter campaign, and I think now I'm working a deal to get the books in Borders and Barnes and Noble and on Amazon and things like that. So, you know, we've got a few irons in the fire. Like I said, maybe an animated series, working on audiobook. And you know, it's kind of like with everything. You work, and you see what happens. You know, you test the waters, see what works and what doesn't, and kind of focus and concentrate on what does.
All right.